Okay. So, as I said, chapter 5, we're going to hopefully finish up today. I want to also ask you to, if I can get your attention, please. I'd like to also ask you to meet me in the lab on Wednesday. We're going to do another in-class exercise, number 3, and we'll be doing a number of if-then analysis. I noticed that in our classwork last week, the basic understanding of how to create a if statement was there, but the syntax was a little bit shaky. So we're going to get a little more practice in actually writing these statements. We'll see some examples as we move through some of our examples in our slides today. I want to move quickly through the ones we have finished so far and get into a discussion of if then else logic. So just to jog your memory, if you remember, we were trying to determine how to syntactically come up with a conditional expression that might be, for example, for the following logic. So if we wanted to determine if someone's age was between, let's say, 25 and 30, you noted that that kind of a condition would be wrong. The right way to write it would be if age greater than 25 and age less than 30. And we talked last time about short strict evaluation. In particular, this case is an and if this part of the condition were true, would short circuit evaluation take place? Okay, no, it wouldn't. Because it would have to see if this part was true to evaluate the entire expression. If this part were false, would short circuit evaluation take place? Yes, because if any part of an or an and condition is false, of course the entire expression evaluates to be false. You'll see questions about this on the next exam. Any questions about this short circuit evaluation concept? And I told you that there would be a situation where I would show you why this is useful. And I think I have it here on the slides. Here. Now, one of the problems with any expression that involves division of a variable by a variable, any time you have division by a variable, you must guard against what? Zero. Basic mathematics. And in computer science, one of the things that cause many systems to fail is because there's really no safeguard against that happening in an execution sequence. In other words, if an execution sequence finds that expression and number has zero, it'll bomb. Computer will stop, keyboard will freeze, screen will stop, everything stops. Okay? So take a look at the example here in the slide, you can see how we can use short circuit evaluation to guard against the possibility of division by zero. Here, we have an AND condition whose first part says number not equal to zero. And then when it evaluates this expression, it then will not evaluate this part if the number is equal to zero. But we could use this very simple example to keep an expression that has a division from being executed, an expression. This is the logical expression. There's no real processing being done here. But there could be an example. I don't know if I have it here. My slides are not as... Okay, but... All right, let me give you another example. Give you an example where you actually want to execute something. Let's say you've got a an annual rate, and you want to convert that to a monthly rate or a quarterly rate. Or the bi-monthly or biannual rate. You might have something called period that may be read from a file or key in from the keyboard or something of that nature. So you want to divide this by period. How can I guard against this expression evaluation using short circuit evaluation? I mean, how can I guard against the possibility of a period being zero and causing this expression to be wrong and to shut down? Do I have a hand? Oh, no. How about help me out here? How could I use short circuit evaluation? Yeah. How can I use short circuit evaluation? To guard against the possibility of period being zero. Tell me. What do I write here? Okay. What would I write here to guard against this expression being evaluated?
Whatever not equal.
The following. Do I need parentheses?
Yeah.
I do.
What if you use if for the period? If period is not equal to zero, then you put the rates is equal to in the parentheses.
That
in the source statement, you put the rates is equal to unnormalized.
Okay, I'll write that in just a second. That's also a good rule. But I actually want to finish that. Do I need parentheses here? Well, what has the highest precedence here? What operators do I work? Am I working? Does that have the highest precedence?
Yes.
Okay, so that means that this would be evaluated first, right? What has the next highest precedence? Okay, so division would be the next, right? What do you want to have the next precedent? And, right? Because you want to use that to short circuit this. So the answer to my question is yes. You need to practice.
kind of an assignment statement.
That's an assignment statement. Assignment statements are done when? First or last? First or last? Last. Why? They have the lowest precedent. Does that make sense? You want everything to be done over here and have the assignment done last. This whole thing is an expression. These are operators. I mean, they often look like something different to you because you're reading in English. But from a computer, from a pirate standpoint, these are just operators. And it's evaluating this expression based on the precedence of these operators. So we have to be careful that we understand the precedence, or we can just put parentheses around everything and make it explicit to make it clear how we're going to be evaluated. Especially when you have a possibility of something being done out of sequence in terms of what you intend. Okay? So it's not quite like English. It's like mathematics and English combined. And you have to be careful that you don't get an ambiguous statement or a statement that has a syntax that's correct, but a semantic, a meaning that's not what you intend. Correct. It says what I wanted to say and it means what I want it to mean, but because you haven't taken consideration of precedence and evaluation sequence, it will not operate and you'll be sitting there for hours trying to figure out the program that doesn't work. You actually haven't had that frustration yet, but you will. So, now, you said there's another way of doing this that might look a little cleaner. I think this is what you're alluding to. As an easier way of safeguarding the possibility of period being zero? Yes. However, to write this, I don't know. Either one is probably okay. One takes a little longer to do than the other, but that's still fits here. Any questions about this short circuit evaluation and how to use it? Moving on. All right. So, this is just a reminder that expressions has a value which can lead to unexpected results. Construct your expressions carefully. Use precedent charts in terms of order. Here's an example that we put on the board earlier regarding how to find something within a range. And let's try to analyze what happens here real quickly. If we were to write this expression, then we know that this part would be evaluated first. It would come out to be a zero because, it would come out to be 1, and 1 is less than 80, and so it would come out to be a very distinct value from what you might have said, that being the right way to write that logic. Here's our example that I was alluding to for our assignment, where we are subtracting 2 floating point numbers and we are comparing their difference, in this particular case, the absolute value of the difference because we don't know which one is greater. So what we find here is this result is going to be their proximity, plus or minus, and then we can specify a tolerance, and that's what our author in the slide says is close enough. So be careful as you prepare floats. So we know that selection structures are used to choose between 2 depending actions. We're going to get 2 actions, but we're going to look at another construct here. I'm just going to go through this real quickly. We all understand this is review. If then else logic. And then we're going to hopefully touch upon nested if. And that'll help us prepare for, I believe,
believe what's in our lab content for this week, as well as what's in our in-class assignment for Wednesday. But here, I want to note a number of things. First of all, we have the guard against dividing by zero. And we have a construct with the if clause, and this set of braces here is a way of creating a body of statements that become the if clause in the statement. And here, if we have more than one statement, that's an if. If more than one statement that's in your if clause, you must surround them by braces. What would happen if we did not? What if we actually had this expression, this if statement, without these parentheses, without these braces, I'm sorry? Would the compiler catch it? Syntax error? Somebody's thinking, yeah.
The if is a function, so it has to the braces less than.
Well, if's not a function, but if is a command that requires an expression that looks like a parameter. This is actually a condition.
Okay.
But the problem with this is that this would cause syntax error. It would cause syntax error because of that else. And I think the error would come up to say something in regard to an else without an if. An else must follow an if. If we did not have these braces, that if and that condition would only go with that statement right there. It would only go with the next statement following. Then this statement would be executed in sequence. And then it would get to this statement and would say, no, that else cannot exist without an if. Let me see if I have a few more examples here in my slides. Where we have if clauses, and subsequently also else can have a block of statements, forming an else clause. Here we have an example of that. And we want to be very careful. I noticed that a number of students who were putting together conditions didn't realize that the entire condition has to be surrounded by parentheses. And there's an individual parts of this case, the and expression has its own individual parentheses. I also noticed a number of you just had a single equal sign here. And that was causing a problem. You're just going to have a problem. Let's move on.
Professor?
Yes?
What happens when you don't use parentheses? Here you see.
Well, what happens if you don't use parentheses here? It'll give you a syntax error. It'll say, I've got an understanding of that, but it doesn't understand what that and does now. So we'll probably give you an error related to the and. So here's another example of a syntax error that semantically looks pretty clear to the human reading this understanding, but syntactically it would cause an error. Braces can be omitted only when the clause has a single statement, which is what is illustrated here. And you can have I've noted this. Were writing these enormously long C-out statements, that you can separate them into multiple lines. It doesn't become two statements, even though it takes up multiple lines, but only terminates when that punctuation is semicolon is accounted.
it's a multi-line statement, but not two statements. Okay, so here's an example. We're going to assign 25% discount rate and $10 value to shipping costs if the purchase is over 100. So we're going to do two things to our purchase by adding a shipping cost and subtracting a discount. Everybody's familiar with this logic. And otherwise assign a 0.5 or 15% discount rate and assign a $5 value to shipping. So either way, let's calculate the total bill. So here's the logic that we're trying to illustrate, and here is our algorithm for that logic written in C++. Where our purchase is greater than 100, our discount rate is 0.25, our shipping cost is $10, and here we take the shipping cost, either 10 or 5, and we add it to our purchase that's been adjusted by our discount rate. Just for sake of argument, what kind of operator is this? Plus, is it floating point addition or integer addition? Floating point addition. What if shipping costs were an integer? Because anytime you have, I don't know who's talking to you, right? You are? So if I understand what you're saying, anytime you have a float involved in an expression, even though the other operand in that expression might be integer, the result of the evaluation is going to be the highest precision floating point, and that would mean that that would be floating point here, and even if purchase were a integer, the result of the multiplication would be floating point. Even if shipping costs were an integer, the result of this addition would be floating point. But the total bill, if it were an integer, would be truncated to an integer if that were the case. Okay, so let's continue to move on. I want to show you some more interesting Gibbs-Kanyel's logic. Oh, this is just, remember our int main always has a return of what?
Zero.
And one of the reasons why this slide is included to terminate a program. Now, I wonder why you need. What question here?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Well, it says not void main. That was pretty confusing.
Well, shouldn't be, because void main is perfectly allowable.
Try it, sir.
I'm sorry.
We did a lot of code, so.
Did you get marked wrong?
I think I did. I'm not sure.
What did you respond? The program was wrong, except we have anything?
Apparently.
Why don't you take a look at your result and get it back? Okay? Yeah, you can avoid me. As a matter of fact, most of the programming that was done earlier with C++ and C was done with void. But the reason why we have this return zero now is because if the program executes entirely correct, it returns an operating system. I'm sorry. It returns a zero back to the operating system. So we hadn't thought about this before, but you just think about main as being a single executed program that's in a single execution without any dependencies. It's very rare that you just operate a program. Many times, programs are series of programs. I'm sorry. Systems are made up of series of programs. For example, let's say a payroll run, a payroll system. A payroll system may have many programs that execute in sequence. And very often, one of those programs may fail for one reason or another. Maybe the input's not available.
maybe somebody has inadvertently written the wrong program construct and divided by zero. Maybe someone has not input data in the proper format and corrupted the input. Any number of things can happen. But if you can think regarding the sequence of events that might take place before the actual printer prints checks, you would want not to get to the point of printing checks, check paper, okay? And then find out, oops, it's wrong. You know, throw those checks away or shred them, get a new stack of checks, put them on the machine, run the check, run again, and oops, it's still wrong. Okay? So now, if you have each one of these programs, if they function correctly, if they go to a main that's all the way through to the bottom, they'll return zero back to the operating system, which means to the operating system, run the next program. So now you have these individual programs, sometimes 50 dozens of programs, executing and returning zero back to the operating system. And so if it gets all the way to the end, and all those programs return zero, and the operating system then executes the next one, then it'll get to the printer process and print the checks, and the checks will always be right. So that was one of the reasons why, from an operational perspective, this return zero and int main were used instead of void main. That won't be tested. Yes. Well, it could be one if you want, in this particular case, for the whole sequence to be terminated, the program to be terminated, or it could be a error message code that it returns back to the operating system, so the operating system can display back to the user, the disk drive is busted, or the CD is corrupt, or something that could give them a better indication of why the program failed. So yeah, it could be something other than one. Yes, sir.
Could it be two or three?
Two, three. Okay. I've never seen a float main where it would be 2.7. But very often you want to return something to the operating system that says it's not zero, meaning true, it's executed properly. It's something other than zero, meaning it's a zero in this particular case would be okay. But it's something other than zero, and specifically, you might have a condition that produces a one, another condition that returns two, another condition that returns three, depending upon how it might fail. Now, when you open a file, I'll give you a more practical example of a program failure. As many of you have encountered a problem, and I've seen this happen in the lab, where your program looks fine, but it's not reading your input file. And we've had to make sure that input file was included in the project, and sometimes it got in the wrong folder group into resources versus source code or something like that. Everybody understand what I'm talking about? Both of you had this problem. One of the best things to do after you have opened an input file would be to test to see if the file has been opened properly. So you might have a construct like this. You might say infile.open mydata.dat. And immediately after opening it, you want to see if the file has been available to open, because in the past, if it wasn't open properly, your program still executed and you didn't have a result and you couldn't figure out why. So you want to get into the practice of doing this. Yeah. Not info. Why? Because this object, if this open method applied to that object is successful, it'll change the value of the object to be zero. I'm sorry. Yeah. Get to be zero.
We see how the logic works now. So if it's zero, what will be the value of this expression? I got one person. Anybody understand what I'm asking? If I say here, N5 is zero if it's okay. Meaning you've got the CD in the drive or specify the location of my data properly or it's in the folder where the project is or it's part of the project, group of files, but whatever the condition might be. If that's not true, if that's true and it finds that file to open it, N5 will be equal to zero. So my question was, if N5 is equal to zero, what's the value of not zero? Okay, but ordinarily it is, but I want a single answer. It's one, meaning true. So the opposite of false, not false, is true. Right? And so if it's true, then it'll terminate the program. A return terminates the main function. A return terminates any function. In this particular case, I don't think it's being made functional here with terminate the entire program. So get in the habit of doing this. Oh, you might also want to do it. Cout file read error. You know, I know all of you have seen error messages. All of you have had a problem understanding what is that error message saying? When you click on it, it goes to a line and you can't even understand whether it's something very cryptic. Okay? So be part of the solution instead of the problem. Make an error message that says something. You'll have instances where you'll have to create error messages in the future in the program. So be part of the solution. Just don't say error, take something.
Or seeing if you don't put, like, let's say you have like two answers and input just one and enter, it still gives you okay.
Yes. It'll still continue to function, what you're saying. Still return.
Yes.
Okay.
Instead of giving you this, why?
Well, because. I think you're saying if you put in here, let's say 27, and then hit return. It'll obviously put the 27 in here. Okay? It'll leave this. It's leaving, it wasn't initialized, it'll leave whatever that value was in memory of the program before it left something in it. Well, by the way, when you do this, take int x, y, and allocate space right here in memory, and whatever was there, if you don't initialize it, will stay. So I think this will become initialized. It'll have its initial value. It won't fail. Now, how can you keep that from happening? Well, we just said it. It goes on without having Y in it, and it calls some very erroneous populations. And it appears the program is done right, but it hasn't because you didn't enter more than two integers. You didn't enter two integers. So my question is, based on what we've learned so far here, how might you guard against this program? Testing what?
Test
oracles. No, test oracles.
Initialize both of them and check if they were the same value after.
Correct. Okay. So he says that the way to do it would be to follow. It's just all good, clean programming. assuming that somewhere here there's a prompt and it says enter a positive integer other than 0. Okay? And so the test here, and I got the wrong test. Right? Because what I would prefer to do is this. If either of these is still zero, meaning nothing was entered here, then stop. And as I said, be part of the solution. Give me a C out error message. You know, C out one of the parameters, one of the inputs that was not zero, something like that. So that you would know why I terminated the stop. Okay? All right. So, as I said, and here, Wednesday we'll meet up in the lab. A lot of you are having a problem finishing up in that 50 minutes I give you, so I suggest get there on early. And it looks like we've probably got a classroom size adequate for the number of students, so I don't think I'm going to have any overflow. But bring your laptops nevertheless. Okay? I'll see everybody on Wednesday. It's okay. That's all right. I got to stop recording. Oh, okay. That's all right. I got it.